In mathematics, we often solve for x, but what about y? The quadratic formula is probably one of the most commonly taught formulas in math class, and rightfully so, it is very useful for many different types of problems, but I would bet many of you have just memorized this without ever knowing where it comes from. So that's what I want to explore today. To start, we need a quadratic equation. Since I want to show this is true for any quadratic equation, I'm not going to assign any specific numbers within this equation, but just leave it as ax squared plus bx plus c equals 0. Now remember, our goal here is to solve for x. If we think of this on a graph, we have a parabola and we're trying to find where it crosses the x-axis, or in other words, where are the zeros or the solutions to this quadratic equation. Normally, in algebra, if we had an equation and we were solving for x, we'd move everything to the other side that doesn't have an x in it, divide by the coefficients. But in this case, if you try that, it's not really going to work because we have this x squared term and this x term, which we can't combine. So we can't ever isolate one x all by itself. But we could at least start by getting this x squared to be alone by dividing by a to get rid of the coefficient. But if we divide this first term by a, then of course we have to divide every term by a in order to keep the equation in balance. So now we have x squared plus b over a x plus c over a equals 0. From here, depending on the numbers in your equation, you might be able to factor. Factoring is often a lot faster and simpler than using the quadratic formula or completing the square or using other strategies. But remember, in this case, we don't know the values of a, b, and c, so we don't know if we can factor. So we're going to use a strategy that will work no matter what. It would be really cool if we could rewrite this side of the equation to look like x plus something quantity squared. Now the reason that would be really cool is because then we would only have one x in our equation. We could take the square root of both sides, subtract out what we were adding to x, and get x all by itself. But how can we do that when we don't know if this is a perfect square? Well, let's make one. I'm going to take this c over a and subtract it from both sides so that on the left side we only have the terms that contain an x. So thinking back to our goal of we want x plus something quantity squared, just for now, I'm going to call that something y. So we have x plus y quantity squared. That's our goal. We want to get this left side of our equation to look like this. So I'm going to think about this algebraically first. If we multiply out x plus y quantity squared, we get x squared plus 2xy plus y squared. Looking at what we have on the left side of the equation, we already have an x squared, so that's good. Both of these second terms have an x in it. In our equation, we have b over a, x. But in this other equation, we could think of this as 2y, x. So in other words, if we replaced this 2y with b over a, our second terms would look the same. So let's set 2y equal to b over a and solve for y. We divide both sides by 2, and we find that y equals b over 2a. Now, how does this help us? Well, we notice this third term is y squared. In our original equation, we don't have a third term, but we could add one. So this is telling us to add y squared, but we know y equals b over 2a. So in other words, we want to add b over 2a quantity squared. If we do that, then we can work back to get this x plus y quantity squared. So if I add b over 2a quantity squared to this side, then I must add it to the right side of my equation as well in order to keep things balanced. But now in doing so, I can now rewrite the left side of our equation as x plus b over 2a quantity squared. And if you still aren't really convinced by that, go ahead and multiply out x plus b over 2a quantity squared and see if we get right back to that left side of our equation. However, I want to go backwards a few steps and think about this geometrically, because I think visualizing this is really cool and really helpful to actually understand what we're doing here. Some of you may know that this strategy that we've been doing is called completing the square. And that makes sense because we have this squared term that we're trying to get this perfect square. However, thinking of it geometrically, we can think of literal squares. So for example, look at this x squared term. We can draw this as a square with area x squared. Or in other words, a square with side lengths x. For the second term, b over a, x, that's not a square. However, we can still draw a figure that has the area b over a, x. And it would be a rectangle with one side length being x and the other side length being b over a. Just to double check, we know that the area of a rectangle is length times width. So if we took x times b over a, that does in fact get us right back to our second term. But our goal here is still to get that squared term on the left side of our equation. Right now, we just have a square plus a rectangle. We want to turn this into a square. I notice that both our square and our rectangle have a side length of x. So if I cut my rectangle in half and I add it to the sides of the square, now our square has side length of x plus half of b over a. Or in other words, x plus b over 2a. And that's true for both sides of this square. However, it's not quite a square anymore because we're missing this piece in the corner. But if we could find a square to insert into this piece like a puzzle, it would form a perfect square. So let's think about what side lengths this little square would need. The short side of the rectangle is b over 2a, and the side lengths of this square consist of the short sides of the rectangle. So if we add a square of side lengths b over 2a, we will be completing the square. So the area of this little square would be b over 2a quantity squared, because the area of a square is the side length squared. So this picture has showed us that what we need to add to both sides of our equation to complete the square is b over 2a quantity squared, which is exactly what we found by doing it algebraically. So once again, if we have x squared plus b over a x plus this new term that we added, b over 2a squared, then on the other side of our equation, we have negative c over a plus that new term, because if we added it to the left, we must add it to the right. So plus b over 2a quantity squared. Now the whole point of adding this term was so that we could condense the left side of our equation into x plus something quantity squared. So again, thinking back to that square picture that we drew, this new square that we created has side length x plus b over 2a. So to find the area of the whole square, which would be the entire left side, we can take x plus b over 2a quantity squared. And that would give us the area of this whole square. Or thinking algebraically, again, if you aren't convinced, you could multiply this back out and get right back to that left side of the equation. I know this still looks a little bit complicated, but don't worry, we are on the home stretch. From here on out, our goal is again just to isolate that x term, which is a lot easier now since we only have one x term. Before we isolate x, let's just make this right side look a little bit neater. B over 2a squared can be rewritten as b squared over 4a squared. We have two fractions being added together, so in order to combine those into one fraction, we need a common denominator. We can make this first fraction have a denominator of 4a squared to match the second if we multiply the top and the bottom by 4a. Remember, we have to do the top and the bottom because that's essentially like multiplying by 4a divided by 4a, which is 1. And if we multiply anything by 1, then we're not changing the value of it. So if we multiply the top and the bottom of this fraction by 4a, we now have two fractions with the same denominator, so we can add them together into one fraction. So we would have negative 4ac plus b squared over 4a squared, but just to make it look a little bit neater, I'm going to flip the two terms in the numerator. Since addition is commutative, we can change the order to b squared plus negative 4ac, or in other words, b squared minus 4ac. This might be starting to look a little bit familiar, but we still have a couple more steps to go. Looking back on the left side, remember our goal here is to get x all by itself. So first we should probably get rid of the square, and we can do that by taking the square root. And again, if we take the square root of the left side, we must take the square root of the right side. But keep in mind, when taking the square root, we could have a positive answer or a negative answer. Think about 16. 4 times 4 gives us 16, but so does negative 4 times negative 4. So whenever we take the square root, we actually have plus or minus the square root. So we now have x plus b over 2a equals plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 4a squared. When taking the square root of a fraction, we can separate that into just taking the square root of the numerator and taking the square root of the denominator. And in doing so, the square root of 4a squared can actually simplify to 2a, because 2a times 2a gets us right back to that 4a squared. So now, to isolate our x, we need to subtract a b over 2a from both sides. So we have x equals negative b over 2a plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. But now we have two fractions with the denominator 2a, so we can combine them into one fraction. So we have negative b, or how I was always taught to say, the opposite of b, plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. And that is the quadratic formula. And we can use this formula to solve for x and find the solutions of our equation. And not only that, but we have also seen how to complete the square both algebraically and geometrically. And now the next time you're solving a quadratic equation using the quadratic formula, you can be proud that you have derived this formula yourself. Memorization can be useful in mathematics to solve problems faster, but I encourage you, before you memorize a formula, to explore, think about, understand where it comes from, if possible, so that you have a deeper understanding of the processes that you're doing in math, such as the quadratic formula, essentially derived from completing the square. And now you can see why completing the square is very useful as well. Let me know in the comments what other equations or formulas you've memorized but would like to explore where they come from. Thanks so much for watching, and this was What About Why?